All right. Okay, so one part I think I did not do in the previous session was relative to relative velocity and relative displacement. So I think some of the questions related to that. So let me quickly touch upon this. So if you have two object systems, let's take only two objects as a part of system, and they are moving under influence of internal forces starting from position of rest. So this is also important. They start initially both are at rest. So A and B are two particles, and whenever the only two are there along the line joining to and taking x-axis, it becomes a 1D motion. Okay. So the two systems, they can move under mutual force of attraction or repulsion. It could be either any of the two. See, in this case, if we have to analyze motion of a center of mass, so let's first find out center of mass here. If for whatever system, if somebody take x is equal to zero, if this coordinate is x1 and this coordinate is x2, mass is m1 and mass is m2, this is value of x. We can simply find the center of mass. Now, if due to internal forces, if they move, right now I don't bother, but it has moved to some new position x1 prime and x2 prime is the new position of b at some instance of time. So at that instance of time, if these are the new positions, I'll again have xcm, but I'm not writing xcm prime here. Why I'm not writing xcm prime here? Because if they are moving from initial position of rest, then center of position will not change. That's the principle we are using here. So this and this will remain same despite the fact their positions have changed. They undergone displacement. So let's see what is the relationship between displacement. What do you do here to find displacement? From the second equation, I subtract first equation. When I subtract first equation, this side is zero. So one side becomes zero and denominator also is gone. So it will become equal to m1 into final position minus initial position plus m2 into final position minus initial position, which is nothing but displacement. M1 into delta x1 plus if this is equal to zero. It gives you delta x1 by delta x2, which is nothing but displacements. So displacement is minus m2 by m1. So two things are important. See, mass cannot be negative. The negative sign indicates the displacement must be in the opposite direction. If one moves towards right, other must move towards left. And second thing you notice here, the displacements are inversely proportional to mass. The heavier particle will move smaller distance and lighter particle will move greater distance. So if one of them is m and other is 2m, if 2m mass moves 1 meter in one direction, this m mass will move twice some 2 meter in the opposite direction. So this is something, so let's take the case here. If A has moved towards right by 2 meter and B has moved towards left by 1 meter. If I look at relative displacement, what is the relative displacement? Second thing, when we talk of relative displacement, see, relative displacement in terms of vectors, I would return a displacement of the first particle minus the displacement of the second particle. But when they're in the opposite side, opposite direction, minus minus will add up. So if I write relative displacement magnitude, why I'm writing relative displacement magnitude? If I look at displacement of B from A, it will be negative. Displacement of A seen from B will be positive. So relative displacement may be positive or negative depending on where you are looking at, but magnitude of relative displacement will be same. I'm just writing magnitude of relative displacement, which will be equal to when they are moving the opposite direction, the sum of the magnitude of displacements. So this is something, so if one has 1 meter, another has 2 meter, and I'm not assigning any sign, but they are moving in the opposite direction, relative displacement is 3. But once I have found relative displacement is sum of these two, I can write x2 in terms of delta x2, second displacement in terms of displacement of the first particle. If I write something like this, I get an expression, displacement of the first particle is equal to relative displacement into m2 divided by m1 plus m2. So the relative displacement, if I look at that, is shared in inverse proportion of mass. So whatever relative, so in this case, we have initially taken the displacements are known, and then we are finding relative displacement. So you see how we apply. So whatever we come across, relative displacements are inverse proportion of mass under this condition. And you can, since the displacements are inverse proportion of mass, we divide by time. Even velocities also, at particular time, whatever velocity it requires here. Velocity is also that a smaller particle will have greater velocity. And that would be also inverse proportion of the mass. Even kinetic energy also will be in inverse proportion of the mass. We can easily calculate that. That happens in case of object moving under internal forces. Internal forces could be connected by a spring, or it could be gravitational force or attraction, it could be electrostatic force or repulsion attraction, any of those two. Now we come back to, so let me do this again. I think some of you are not very clear. So, but this is also very common kind of question. Just imagine here, this is spherical shell, as I mentioned here, these things are known. See, what can happen in this case, you need to understand, in this case, if you look at this outer sphere and inner sphere as a system. Forces acting are only in the y direction. It will not have any component in x direction. So xcm position, and since it is released from rest, xcm will remain unchanged. That's what we have to use. Xcm of which system? Xcm of outer spherical shell and inner sphere. To find xcm, and you see what we have done, I have taken some, we have to take some reference. So I have taken along this is equal to x is equal to 0. So if I take this one, and since there are two extended objects, see, whenever we have extended object, it's not necessary to take the center of mass. Any point I can choose, I can do that also. Let me choose in this case. So I have taken center of mass of first sphere, which need not necessarily be center mass. Any point we can take when it undergoes translation. But in case of translation, whatever displacement center of mass will have, any other particle also will have same displacement. So we have taken these two points. So initially also we take these two points, finally also we have to take these two points. So first point is the center, the line is passing through here. So what is this distance equal to? 6r minus r, this is equal to 5r. So if I solve using xcm coordinate, xcm will be equal to m into 5r and divided by total mass, which is 7m. So that's the position of central mass. Let's see what happens if, as soon as we release from here, you know, this under gravity, this will start moving downwards. And as it moves downward, when we start moving in the curved path, as it moves in the curved path, it will exert normal reaction on the spherical shell. This force will be like this in the radial direction. And because of this force, this outer shell also will start having motion in the rightward direction. Now, there are multiple questions in this. One other question also may come. Will outer sphere, will it tend to rotate or it will just translate? So if I mark particular point here, if I put a red dot here on the point, will this also shift or this point, would it rotate or would it just translate here? So this case also, it will just translate because the forces acting are passing through central mass. It will not exert any torque. It will not rotate. Same orientation, whole thing will shift towards right as it will keep going towards left. It will reach the bottom. So when it reaches the bottom, what will happen at this particular instance? When it will pass to the bottom. When it is the bottom, this sphere will have a velocity towards left. And outer sphere at all instances of time will have only horizontal velocity. The center mass height remaining same. So velocity of smaller sphere direction will keep changing. But direction of velocity of outer sphere will always remain horizontal. At this particular point, when it is at the lower small point, both will have horizontal velocity. And beyond that, we'll continue. So it is something we can come across. This question also is relevant from rotational motion. And because of conservation mechanical energy, there's no friction, it will continue like this upper extreme. So if we have to find when it reaches here, what is the displacement of this? So keeping same axis here. So my frame of reference, we have not shifted. We have kept the same frame of reference. Now, this center has moved here. This is this center, which was here, has moved here. And the center of this sphere has moved here. So what I'll do here, let's see this. Let's assume that this is equal to x. What is new xcm here? New xcm will be equal to 6m, only x coordinate. So basically, what you're looking at, we are just looking at, no, I'm not looking at y axis, it's just looking at x coordinate of these two points. It will be 6m into x plus m into what is this distance, and this is negative value. This value for distance from here. See, we don't know the distance from here. What we know from here to here distance is 5r. So this will be, what will this value be equal to? This will be negative value, and this will be, I put minus sign, it will be minus of 5r minus x divided by 7. That's one way to find out. And what I was talking about relative displacement mean if this is one point and this is the second point. Both Mandamu and I am just like Arjuna, I am not looking at y coordinate, only looking at x coordinate. So initially, if I right now, if I look at this, I find if I call this A and this one is the point is B. At this instance, it is at a distance of 5r towards right. And later on, the final portion we are talking, it has moved 5r towards left along the x-axis. So in this case, I look at delta x is equal to 10r. That's the displacement. And this displacement is between bigger sphere and smaller sphere. So what will be displacement of bigger sphere? 6 mr. That's what we are discussing previously. Relative displacement is shared in inverse proportion of mass. So ratio mass is 1:6. I divide by total mass is 7 m. And so this will be equal to 10 r into other mass, which is equal to m divided by 7 m. So that's what we are talking about. I can ask one more question. Some of you can try and solve. Other question could be find the speed of two spheres when a smaller sphere is at the lowest position. This also another question. Some of you can try. At least all of you should try at lowest position. Can someone think of, tell me, how do I find velocities of both this one when it is at the lowest point? How would lowest point would look like when the smaller sphere is at the lowest point? I have not drawn the figure. The lowest point will look something like this. And the smaller one is here. So you can just try and solve that part also. Okay, and this part. And similar way, you can solve this question also. Another important point I just wanted you to understand here. See, this case also similar. Again, if I take x-axis here, I don't have to take center mass. So which point I tap, I just choose one point. So let me choose for 4 m mass. Let me choose the lower corner here. And this mass also, let me choose the lower corner. If I'm looking at relative displacement. And when I look at the x-coordinate, and this is the line here. So when initially, and I look at both, this is the position here. And finally, what has happened? This has moved up. What is the relative displacement here? If I look from here, so this is the position, and this other one. So this, if I look at what is x-component of relative displacement, this is the value. How much is this distance equal to? That distance from here to here is 6L minus L. So this total distance is 6L. So initially the points which are along the same line, now they are separated by distance of along x-axis by 5L. 5L is the relative displacement. And if I choose any other point, we'll find the same thing. Suppose rather than choosing this point, had I chosen this point here. So initially I would have found relative to this point on 4M, this point is towards right by distance L. And finally, compared to for again with reference to the same point, since I'm looking at the relative displacement, this point initially it was L distance, now it is 6L distance. So the relative displacement is 5L. So any two point I can choose, I have to find relative displacement. So I have, once I found relative displacement in x direction or x component of relative displacement is equal to 5L. Again, I can find what 5L, how it is shared between m mass and 4m mass. Who will have more displacement? This will have, compared to this, this will have 4 times displacement. So 4 times means total displacement I divide into 5 and distribute in this ratio. Divide into 5 ratio and then do that. Other important point is, if I ask you in the ground frame, see ground frame motion of 4m mass is simple. 4m will have this kind of velocity. What is the direction of velocity m will have? So what is the direction of motion of block m? Can someone think of what is direction of motion of m? See, if this block was not in motion, this 4m it remained fixed. So direction of motion of m would have been along the slope. But what has happened? Two things have happened. It has motion along the slope, but whole thing has been shifted towards left. So actual motion of M will be relative motion plus motion of the block. That would be the actual direction of displacement of block M. So this question, this is relevant for only for some little more difficult question, which may not be necessary up to mains level. But this would be the actual direction of displacement, and this will be displacement of relative displacement, and this is a displacement of 6m block, and this will be the ground displacement of block. So its motion is something like this. So if I look from the frame of reference, this point when it is reached here, from initial this was somewhere here, it has moved. Now coming to this question also, I will do one more part in this question. So initially if it is kept like this, as soon as I release, what is the motion of 6M? Can someone define what will be nature of motion of 6M? What is the nature of motion of 6M mass here? Can anyone think of what is the nature of motion about 6M mass here? Arel, can you tell me what will be the nature of motion of the 6M mass?
I'm not sure.
Not sure. This okay. Anybody else you can think of what is the nature of motion of 6M block? It is not so simple. So that's why I'm asking. Otherwise, in a different book. Anybody else who can tell what is the nature of motion? Alat, can you tell me what is nature of motion of 6M?
So like circular, but it's moving to the right. Circular, but it's moving to the right a little bit.
Yeah, basically, I think there's a circular. It is motion. If I see in the ground frame, it is not easy to understand. But relative to M mass here, so its motion can be better defined with respect to M. So if I have to say relative to M, its motion will be circular. So relative to M, circular motion. So since M also is moving towards right, so it is along with the circular motion, it will also have rightward velocity. So that will come to that point later. But in this case also, XCM will remain same. So I can do something similar to what we had done earlier. I can choose some axis, and again from there we take coordinate and XCM will remain constant. Or if I do from relative frame of reference, what is relative here? Initially, its position with respect to the ring was L towards right. And now that is with respect to the ring, it has become zero. It has gone relative displacement of L. So here, delta X relative is L, which is shared between the ring and the block. This is shared relative displacement because they are in the opposite direction. So both have contributed to relative displacement of L, ring as well as block. And ring mass is M, block mass is 6M. Of course, this will move whatever distance this has moved, it will move 1/6 of the distance. If this has moved X, this will move X by 6. So I can think of another way so that X plus X by 6 will be equal to L. That's another way I can think of. Now, there's one more thing I can add here. At this particular instance, when the string has become vertical, will these two things will be at rest or both will be in motion? Is that easy to tell? Will both of this 6M and the ring, there are two things here, ring and the block. Will they be in the state of rest? Will they come and stay here only, or will they still be in the state of motion? I think this is fairly easy to understand. At this particular instant, you know, this is started moving towards right and this is moving towards the rotation motion. At this instance, of course, at all instances, this ring only had horizontal velocity. At this particular instance, this one, since its velocity is always perpendicular to the thread, since thread is vertical, its velocity also will be horizontal. So this velocity is V1 and this velocity is V2, both are in the opposite direction. Can we find out speed also at this instance? Yes, it is possible to find speed. Because in this case also, one way of finding the speed would be, if this is V1 and this is V2, we have done already, what is the ratio of speed? The ratio of speed, magnitude of velocity. What is the ratio of velocity of V1 and V2? Both are in the x direction. Both are in the, because here both are in the which direction? Both are x component. Since Here, no external force in x direction, both have x component. H will be, ratio will be in inverse proportion of mass. So V1 velocity, and if I take velocity this by this ratio, mass has to be 6m by m. This ratio will be equal to 6m by m. That's the ratio. So 6 is to 1. So if this velocity is V, this velocity will be equal to 6V. And this we are talking about ground frame. Can we find velocity now? Now we can find these two values. How do you find value? By conservation of mechanical energy. In the whole process, there's no friction anywhere. There's no loss of energy. So initial energy, if I take this as initial state, and this I take as a final state, and this I take as a reference level for potential energy. Initial potential energy I could have written as M into G into L plus 6M into G into L. That's initial potential energy has to be equal to, initially there was no kinetic energy, that has to be equal to 1 by 2 into 6M into V square plus 1 by 2 kinetic energy of this particle. This will be equal to M into 6V square plus this mass is M, MGL. So basically what we are noticing here, this is the loss of potential energy, and this potential energy resulted into kinetic energy. So one way, another way of thinking, whatever kinetic energy has, whatever, this is the kinetic energy which has been generated. This loss of potential energy got converted to kinetic energy. This kinetic energy also will be shared between ring and the block. What ratio it will be shared? Again, it will be shared in inverse proportion to the mass. So this mass is M and this mass is 6M. So if this has kinetic energy K, this will have kinetic energy of 6K. Or total 7K is to equal to 6MG.
Sir?
Yes?
So here, why can't we just like use the law of conservation of energy using the mass 6M? Because no other force is doing work on it, right? Except gravitational force.
No, why can't we use? We are using conservation mechanical energy.
No, I mean, without taking the two masses as a system. Like taking really, only
what the mass happens in this case, this also will have kinetic energy. No? This also will acquire kinetic energy.
Yes, sir.
No. Other thing, what you are thinking here? Okay. Then, okay. You are saying why? Okay. What will happen in this case? Okay. Very good point. Is the displacement and tension always mutually perpendicular in this case? It is not.
Ground frame of reference.
Because in addition to circular motion, there's a displacement. That's the reason why can't we take it. Very good point. Have you followed what I said?
Yes, I got it, sir.
You got it. So we cannot apply directly on this point alone, because in addition, it is not having at that odd particular stage. So when it is something like this, so if you take some intermediate state, it is something like this. The ring is like this. At that particular time, velocity is not like this. It has also has this component. That's the reason.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, in frame of like the ring which is there.
Hmm?
It loves circular motion, right? So can we apply a law of conservation of energy to only that block in that frame?
No, but this frame of reference, what happens then in that case? First of all, this ring will have acceleration. And if I use this frame of reference, I need to, and acceleration will keep on varying. I need to apply pseudo force there.
Okay.
And you know, the acceleration will not be constant. See, the acceleration will keep on changing. So it becomes a little complex in between. So I hope this part is understood, and I will come to some more questions which are something like this. This also came up to mains level. Not many questions are expected like this, but okay, it's good to know this. Next one. So basically that was related to relative velocity and how displacement, relative displacement, velocity, kinetic energy are shared. Now I'll come to some more questions which are only related to motion of center of mass, so that we understand that part better. Let's see an object A of mass 2 kg. This object mass A 2 kg is dropped from a height of 30 meters. At the same distance, object B of mass 4 kg is projected up from the ground with the initial speed of 15 meters per second. Question is, find the maximum height attained by center of mass with respect to Or suppose, see, this is, in this case, I have two objects. Can I treat this as one single object as a central mass and observe motion of central mass alone? So rather than treating two objects, since I have to find maximum height of the central mass, let me convert into motion of central mass. So when I talk motion of central mass, what are things which are relevant? To find motion of central mass, I need to know initial position, initial velocity of central mass, and initial acceleration or uniform acceleration. So three things I need to know. So when I convert to center mass, first thing I need to do, I need to replace with the mass of 6 kg placed at its central mass. That's first thing I need to do. So solving as a single particle as motion of central mass. First thing, height of center mass from the ground will be equal to 2 into 30 plus 4 into 0 divided by 6, which comes equal to 10 meters. Height of central mass is 10 meters from here. Second thing, then I need to calculate what is velocity of center mass. How do we calculate velocity of center mass? M1 V1 plus M2 U2 divided by M1 plus M2. So I'll 4 into 15 divided by 6. That this has zero velocity initially. So initial velocity of single particle of center mass is equal to UCM, which comes equal to 10 meter per second. Acceleration, both have same acceleration. Acceleration of center mass also will be equal to minus 10. So I can replace these two particles with the motion of center mass. So this motion and central mass, I have placed initial position at height of 10 meter, given an upward velocity of 10 meter per second, and it will have a downward acceleration, ACM. ACM is equal to M1 A1 plus M2 A2. I know both are equal, that's why it comes equal to minus 10. This is the motion it has. Now it is fairly simple. If initial velocity is 10 meter per second, from a height of 10 meter, what is the maximum height will rise? Okay, it will rise for, it will go up, central mass will rise for only for 1 second. For 1 second only it will rise, and from here what is further height you will reach maximum height, V square by 2G, or other way also I can calculate 5 meter. So what will happen, the center maximum height from the ground of center mass will be 5 meter. The same question we can reword it. What is the reword of this question? Rather than the writing find the maximum height, I could have written slightly different way. Well, and you see that moment I write something like this, and that has confused many people. Many people got confused. If I, rest of the question remains same. We change the question. If two particles suffer mid-air inelastic collision. So those two particles projected inelastic collision. So both of them, inelastic collision means they form into one combined mass. Okay. So when they form, when they have collision, they become one mass. And where would that collision take place? At the central mass. So basically, after they become one mass, their motion becomes their position, velocity, and acceleration. Everything becomes same as central mass. Because two particles combined, that itself, the central mass and particle becomes same. So if the question was, if they suffer mid-elastic collision, what is the maximum height the combined mass will rise after elastic collision? The combined mass also will have in between collision, and after having mid-air collision, it will reach a maximum combined height of 50 meter only. That was a similar question which had come in the maze in the past. Not exactly the same like this, so basically something similar we can do. Okay. Something again more about this is like this. A trolley is moving in the smooth surface with a V, velocity V. So this is a trolley which is moving at a constant velocity. It is moving the velocity V. And it is not changing. Okay, so this is there's some mechanism through which it is maintained at constant velocity, maybe some pulleys. A man starts running from the rear end of the trolley with the velocity of 3V/2 respect to the trolley. This is not the ground velocity, this is a relative velocity. So on surface of the trolley, he is running at the speed of 3V/2. After reaching the other end, so he started from here. How is this motion? He starts from here. He runs at the speed of 3V/2 in the forward direction. Reaches this point and again turns back. And continues running with the velocity of 3V/2 relative, all case relative velocity, until he reaches the rear end. So he comes back at the rear end. The question is, if length of the trolley is L, find the displacement of man with respect to Earth when he reaches the starting point. What he says, suppose you as an observer, you're standing here when the man has started running. So when he completes his run and come back, how far this man would be from the starting point? What is the ground displacement? Mass of the trolley and man are equal. Okay. So actually, in this case, mass and trolley are not relevant here because it's moving with the constant velocity. So let's look at some question or something like this. It's more of relative velocity as well. See, what we notice here, first thing, what is velocities are given with respect to trolley. So whenever information is given with respect to something moving, it's better to solve the question in that frame of reference. Since the motion is defined related to trolley, let's better solve the question also in terms of trolley frame of reference. So I'll attach a coordinate system. Where is the coordinate system now? Coordinate system is attached to the trolley itself. And this coordinate system also is moving with velocity v. So as I see in this coordinate system, what is happening? So if you as an observer, you're attached to the coordinate system, you're standing here. You will see this man running away. It doesn't matter about the trolley's motion or not. You will see him going away with the speed of 3v by 2. And you will see him coming back with the speed of 3v by 2. His motion in trolley, his ground velocity will be different, but his velocity as seen from this moving frame of reference, that's what is given in the question. So both ways, time to reach the end of the trolley in this frame of reference, and whatever time is independent of frame of reference. So time taken will be equal to distance by speed. In this distance L by 3V by 2. And it will take same time to reach back to the starting point. Displacement will be trolley. So both cases, so total time for him to complete the run is equal to twice of this, which is because of 4L by 3V is the time he has taken to come back to the same end of the trolley. So in the frame of reference of the trolley, zero displacement, time taken is so much. But what will the ground displacement? So in his position everywhere same, ground displacement will be equal to same as it. So ground, what is ground displacement equal to? So whenever we talk about ground displacement, here are the two men here. We are talking about man and the trolley. So if I talk about displacement of man with the trolley, with respect to trolley, is the displacement of man minus displacement of trolley. If this part is zero, what is the displacement of man? Displacement of man is nothing but displacement of trolley. So during the period, what is the ground displacement of the man? If the trolley has moved here, it is equal to displacement of trolley in the ground frame. And displacement of trolley in the ground frame is moving the constant speed v. Time is 2L by 3v. Hence, its displacement in the ground frame will be equal to, the displacement, it will be 4L by 3. So here, by the time it comes back, it would have moved a distance of 4L by 3. So this question, it appears like something about the central mass. There is nothing because here, internal force is not taken into account. The velocity is not changing. Okay, I'll give one more question on motion of central mass and sympathetic. This question you will not usually, we won't find anywhere. And it's good to understand how we analyze motion of central mass. Just see that one. There are two blocks, A and B. It's a kind of a revision of friction also. It involves some concept of friction. It also involves concept of circular motion. Let's see that one. Two blocks, A and B are there. This mass is M and this is 4M. This is 4M. I think somewhere I made a copy mistake. And 4M and connected by string. Both are connected by string. And they are placed in horizontal surface. So when looking at this figure, we are looking from the top. This is all in the horizontal surface. It's rotating constant velocity omega. It is rotating constant velocity omega. And the way they are placed here, from the axis of rotation, A is at a distance r, and B is a distance of 2r. So that's how they are rotating. So both are not, so if I see little later, I will see this A here, and B I'll see here. But they will always be diametrically opposite. Both are undergoing circular motion. There's no friction between A and the surface, but between B and the surface, this coefficient of friction is mu. So they're connected by a string only. This has no friction. And if they continue to undergo circular motion without slipping, what must be the minimum coefficient of friction at B? So if I have to analyze this one, I can analyze as two independent objects undergoing circular motion. But reason I have taken up this question, I'll solve this question using motion of center mass. So there are two particles here I can replace with center of mass motion. So let's see how do we solve in case of center of mass. If two blocks and string together is taken as a system, then it becomes motion of that compasses the center of mass, we can see. So if I take center of mass here, center of mass position comes at a distance of 1.4 r from here. from axis of rotation. Because center mass easily can calculate. Suppose I have to find center mass from midpoint here, it will be equal to 4m into 2r minus m into r. So this is the position of center mass. Okay. So the center mass is at a distance of. So if I look at motion of center mass, can I define what is the nature of motion of center mass? Center mass also is, since both are undergoing circular motion, this also is undergoing circular motion in a radius of 1.4 r with an angular velocity omega. So if it is undergoing circular motion, the external force must be equal to mr omega square. What is the external force acting on this combined mass? Then this becomes combined mass 4 mb. What is the force acting in the horizontal plane on this combined mass? Can anyone point out what is the force acting on this, which is making it move in the circular path? What is the external force? Is there external force, if I look from sideways, is any external force acting in the horizontal plane on A? In horizontal plane, both the forces are vertical, external force. On A, there's a tension acting, but if I take this two as a system, tension is internal force. So there's no external force acting, but some external force acting on B. What is external force acting on B is friction. So all two objects together as a system, only external force which we are concerned about in the horizontal direction is friction force. So if I take the motion of the center mass, I have to take only external force acting in the friction force. And the friction force will act like a centripetal force. So what is the equation I get here? Equation I get here. Friction force is mu times maximum, and since we are talking about minimum coefficient of friction, it means friction which is acting is already at its limiting state. So hence the friction force will be equal to mu times normal reaction, and the friction has to be equal to total mass 4m, r is equal to 1.4 r into omega square. That's the value of mu. That's how we analyze in case of combined mass here. And once I have found the friction force, and I know what is the friction force acting, I can easily calculate the tension also. What is the force acting on this? Force acting, the tension will act. Tension will act, and we can solve rest of it also. Okay. Some more question which I have given in the worksheet. I'm just giving few hints so that some of you can quickly go through. See, one question which is given was something like this. There is a square associated triangle is cut from a square lamina. Originally, it was like a square sheet here. And a square sheet, will have certain center mass. From a square sheet, a part is cut. And this part which is cut and removed, this is the part which is cut and removed. And the way it is cut, what is given in the question, when suspended from apex P. So this part, when this is a triangular part, this point is apex here. If you suspend this mass from point P, it remains in equilibrium any position. So point, if it is suspended from central mass, then only it remains in equilibrium for any position. It indirectly says the point P, we cut this moon such a pile, the point P itself is my central mass. So point P becomes the central mass for the remaining portion. That's what the question is. So how should I cut a triangular lamina of height h such that it apex becomes the central mass of the remaining portion? So how do we solve this question? The question hint is something similar. So if I take this as y is equal to 0, if I calculate ycm, ycm should come equal to h, which should be equal to mass of the full part into y of the full part minus mass of the cut part into y central mass of the cut part divided by mass of the full part minus mass of the cut. Mass of the full part is equal to, how do we write mass of the full part? Sigma into L square. Mass of the cut part will be equal to sigma into area. Area will be equal to 1 by 2 L into H. And what is YCM? YCM is equal to H by 3. The rest of terms are in terms of L. Is simply we can easily solve the question. There was another question given like this. If it is a square sheet of paper or square, it could be paper, it could be sheet or anything. And if two corners are folded to make it appear like figure 2, these two corners are folded. If it is folded, we need to find if O is taken as origin. If I take this as x-axis and this is y-axis, what is the position of central mass? So central mass, see, number of ways you can solve. One way of thinking, I divide into two parts. If the total mass is m. See, whatever change is happening only in the right part. So left part is m by 2. Right part also is m by 2. So when I here also, this part of the triangle, the mass of this triangle also will be half of the total mass, and this will be m by 2. So whenever he has shape, it is two different shapes here. So what we can do, he had done something similar in the forenoon as well. I can replace both of them with the entire mass. This also, the mass is m by 2. I place the mass m by 2 at its central mass. So I place m by 2 here. If this distance was equal to a, this would be half the distance. This would be equal to a by 2. This is a triangle mass. Mass will be m by 2. But in case of triangle, since height of triangle is a here, it will be equal to a by 3. That's as simple as that. And we can find central mass. Okay, so that is all for today. I think, oh, sorry, one more question was there. I think I noted one more question. A uniform chain of length L. This is something if you have rope or chain which is hung on a pulley and total length is 12. And we see this radius is small. So we assume this length also is L and this side length is L. So if it is like this, it will remain in the equilibrium. If AB is given a slight downward jerk here, it will start slipping downwards. When it starts slipping, the question is here the pulley is small, and that's why I'm taking the total length is L and L. So this part of the length is negligible. That's why small pulley. So acceleration of end B when it has been displaced by distance x. So basically the point here, it has already displaced by distance x here. This is how the rope has moved by distance x here, or chain has moved by distance x here. If it is displaced by x here, the length of the chain on the right hand side becomes equal to L plus x. And left hand side, the distance part of the chain which is remaining, it becomes L minus x. So since the lengths are equal, the weights on the masses on two sides are unequal, and it becomes like a at home machine. So this side, so what would be acceleration in that case? It is something if left, this mass is m1 and this mass is m2. We know how the acceleration is. Acceleration is m1 minus m2 divided by m1 plus m2 into g. We can substitute the masses in terms of length lambda into l, and we can easily find an answer. What is velocity of the string when it slips off the pulley? The whole ring is for this whole thing is just the pulley means entire length is on the right hand side. That also we can easily find from conservation of mechanical energy. So I hope remaining question also all of you can easily finish. So that's all I think this for today. I'll stop here. Yes.